My dear friends and my dear masters and my dear gods of the whole world. Today we are going to China to listen to a great guru, to listen to a great master. Confucius, the great sage from China. Masters were born in all the countries of the world. Sages were born in all the nations of the world. And if we want to become a master ourselves, we should take guidance from other masters. If we want to become great teachers ourselves, we should listen carefully to the great teachings of the great teachers of the whole world. So, my dear friends, we are on the path of learning. We have to learn from a Socrates. We have to learn from a Jesus Christ. We have to learn from a Buddha, we have to learn from a Zarathustra, and we have to learn from a Confucius. Today we are going to China, the great land of China, a land of great wisdom, a land of many, many, many sages. And the foremost of them all, the great master, the great sage Confucius. There are many sages, Lao Tzu, Chuang Tzu, Meng Tzu, otherwise called as Mencius. The great land of China is so full of sages. I have read all the sages. I have learned from all of them. For full 6 months in the year 1982, I read nothing other than the Chinese sages. For full 6 months in the year 1982, I was listening nothing other than the Chinese sages, all the sages. I was wonderstruck by their great wisdom. We will listen to one great master, that is Confucius. He existed in the world, on this earth, around 5 to 6 centuries before Christ. At the same time as Buddha, at the same time as Socrates, when these two existed in India and say Greece, Confucius existed in China. As Bhagavad Gita is unto India, the following verse are called as the great learning are by Confucius, they are unto China. I am going to speak the words of Confucius. Let me remind you, my dear friends, these words are called as the great learning in China. This great learning, otherwise called as learning to be great. We have to learn to be great, my dear friends. Great like the greatest. So, this particular piece of wisdom from Confucius, my dear friends, this is called as the great learning. Also called as learning to be great. Please listen very, very carefully. I am now directly quoting from Confucius. Go into a state of meditation, make your minds empty, just for a couple of minutes. Do meditation, be with your breath, normal, natural breath. When you are with the breath, the mind becomes empty. And in an empty, calm and tranquil state, kindly listen to the words that I am going to speak. I am sure you are in meditation. I am sure your mind has become calm. You are being with your breath. Normal, natural, easy, soft breath. The mind becomes calm and tranquil. Let me repeat a few words of Confucius himself. You know what he said? Only after having been calm can one be tranquil. Only after having achieved tranquility can one have peaceful repose. Only after having peaceful repose can one begin to deliberate. These are the words of Confucius. See how he has spoken about calm, tranquility, peaceful repose and deliberations. Let me repeat again, my dear friends. Remember, you are listening to the words of the great Confucius from China. Only after having been calm can one be tranquil. Only after having achieved tranquility can one have peaceful repose. Only after having peaceful repose can one begin to deliberate. These are the great words of Confucius. How can you become calm now? He has not given. He did not talk about meditation.
But he must have been a great, great meditator
to have spoken these words. Unless he has achieved calmness in himself, how can he talk about calm advice to others? So, my dear friends, I request all you to be calm. Now you are going to listen to the great words. They call it the great learning in China. I request you to be calm and tranquil and have a peaceful repose, so that your mind can deliberate on the words that I am going to speak. Now I am speaking for Confucius. Now I am going to mouth his own words. But before I mouth his words again, my dear friends, close your eyes, be with your breath, cross your hands, fingers into fingers, switch off your lights, sit coolly, calmly, and listen to my words. Listen to the words of the great sage Confucius. I am sure you are all calm. I am sure you are full of tranquility. I am sure you are in peaceful repose. Now you can deliberate, grasp, listen to the words that are going to flow from me non-stop. In the words of Confucius, the ancients who wished to manifest clear character to the world would first bring order to their states. Those who wished to bring order to their states would first regulate their families. Those who wished to regulate their families would first cultivate their personal lives. Those who wished to cultivate their personal lives would first rectify their minds. Those who wished to rectify their minds would first make their wills sincere. Those who wished to make their wills sincere would first extend their knowledge. The extension of knowledge consists in the investigation of things. When things are investigated, knowledge is extended. When knowledge is extended, the will becomes sincere. When the will is sincere, the mind is rectified. When the mind is rectified, the personal life is cultivated. When the personal life is cultivated, the family will be regulated. When the family is regulated, the state will be in order. And when the state is in order, there will be peace throughout the world. Wow! What great words from the great sage of China, Confucius. My dear friends, when I first read this passage, I was thrilled and thrilled and thrilled and thrilled. If you want to show the greatness of your country to the world at large, what you should do? You should first set your states in order. There are so many states in India, there are so many states in China, there are so many states in USA, Russia, everywhere. Now the country consists of states. Now each state consists of big families. In those olden days there were big joint families. We are speaking of 5th century before Christ. So each state consisted of big joint families. Each was a tribe. So if you want to set right the state, you had to look after the tribes, the joint families, the families. If your family has to be regulated, unless you give a personal example, your family is not going to be regulated. So if you want to regulate your families, what you have got to do is to cultivate your own personal life. You can't give advice to others without being perfect yourself. You can't have an effect on your family, your surroundings, unless you are perfect in yourself. So, my dear friends, cultivating the personal life forms the basis for community development. It is the dharma of every responsible human being to cultivate one's own personal life to the fullest possible extent. And my dear friend, this is a lifelong commitment. A part of each and every day must be set apart for cultivation of personal life. Like you set apart a certain amount of time each and every day to earn money, to earn your daily bread. In the same fashion, my dear friends, every one of us have to set apart certain amount of time for cultivation of personal life. And what did he say? How is personal life cultivated? Personal life is cultivated when the mind is rectified. We are stuck up with a false mind, a negative mind, an insincere mind, a worldly mind. This mind has to be rectified. We are stuck up with a mind which always abuses others. The parents abuse their own children. Child abuse is so very normal. And we throw the blame on others. For whatever befalls on us, we throw the blame on somebody else. It is a tremendous faulty mind. This mind has to be rectified. Our personal life is in ruins because we are stuck up with a stupid mind, a false mind, an ignorant mind, a foolish mind. This foolish mind has to be rectified. That is why Confucius has said, personal life is cultivated when the mind is rectified. If you want to cultivate your personal life, you must rectify your mind. If you want to cultivate your land, grow some crop on it, then you must clean your plot of all the stubbles, of all the stones, and you must plow it again and again and again and keep it ready, fit for sowing the seeds. Similarly, you have got to become great, sage, then you have to cultivate your personal life. You have to plow the soil. You have to remove all the stubbles and all the stones. You have to make it free of impediments, obstructions. You have to prepare the land for the coming crop, to sow the seeds. The way a farmer cultivates his land, that is the same way a great sage cultivates his own personal life. A great farmer cultivates his soil, his land, then he has a bumper crop. He knows about the science of agriculture. He knows the science of farming, science of producing food from the soil. All the farmers do it. And the sages cultivate their own personal lives. They are forever at work in rectifying their minds. So, if you want, as Confucius said, to rectify your mind, you should make your will sincere. Making your will sincere is another very, very crucial point in rectifying the mind. If you are not sincere in what you want to achieve, what you want to become, then how can you rectify your mind? If you want to become a great musician, like Bismillah Khan, or Mozart, or Beethoven, or Ravi Shankar, then your whole life has to be directed in some other pathway. If you want to achieve greatness in music, like Beethoven, like Mozart, like Pandit Ravi Shankar, you have to do so many things. Daily you must set apart so many hours of practice and practice and practice and practice. If you are not practicing music, it means you are not at all sincere in your goals. Your will is very, very insincere. You don't want to become a great musician, therefore you are not practicing. If you are really earnest in becoming a great musician, you would of course practice. Similarly, if you want to become a great sage, of course you will practice meditation. If you want to become like Jesus Christ, of course you will practice meditation. If you want to become like Beethoven, Pandit Ravi Shankar, practice and practice and practice music.